folklore of Ohio. From the stories of a river in whose depths of crystal waters muskellunge long years abounded. Once a wild and charming river, dear to many tribes of Indians in their days of occupation, named by Delawares Muskingum, called by Shawnees Wakatemo, comes a fascinating legend. Here of brave and daring Duncan, peerless Nimrod of an era, foremost martyr of the traders, vanguard of the migrant millions. Here of an enlightened chieftain and a friendly native people doomed unjustly to oblivion. Ere from out the coastal regions where their ox-drawn clans of settlers came the Seviers to Watauga, or the Boones to dark Kentucky, or the Zanes to the Ohio, ere the westward trails were broken, Duncan, fearless, canny Duncan, by descent a Highland Scotsman from the tidelands of Virginia, entered the Muskingum Valley, famed afar for scenic beauty, fondly termed by thrilled explorers Hudson of the Western Country. Stalwart, straight and trim of figure, in his bearing was the athlete as he strode with step elastic. Striking was he in appearance, clad in buckskin edged with fringes and a blending cap of beaver. In his hands, a trusted flintlock at his side, a horn for powder and a pouch for deadly bullets. Strange device and awesome weapon coveted by every red man. Fleet of foot and keen of eyesight, tales of prowess went before him. Tales of speed and great endurance. Tales of marksmanship fantastic. Skilled in woodcraft, versed in barter, to Muskingum's virgin forests came the hunter. Came the trapper, came the pioneer, the trader. 'Twas a melancholy season when the wild grape pods were purple and the mounds of maize were yellow in the little brush-fenced patches which unhurried squaws attended on the misty river bottoms, when the passengers by thousands hid the sun in eerie darkness from a half-denuded forest. Near the bluffs that shade the river in the sunny hours of morning nestled unpretentious Old Town, seat in Delaware's dominion, often called the Town of White Eyes. With its gloomy bark-thatched wigwams draped with hides of deer and bison dotted through the groves to Salt Creek. Resolute in heart and purpose to the council lodge of White Eyes came the venturer courageous. Here the noble chieftain White Eyes, who was named Coquethagilon by the Delawares, his tribesmen, ruling with paternal justice, sat sustained by humble riches.
Peace to well-respected White Eyes, and greetings to him and his people. I am Duncan, David Duncan, from the province Virginia. I serve not France nor England in this much disputed valley, but have come to trade and barter, earn my way, and be of service.
Nakana, I call you my friend. White Eye speaks the tongue Shawano, English, Delaware, and Huron, Ottawa, Mingo, and others. He has long been friend of white man. Food and teepee always offers, shelters those who help his people.
Much in need, Wakuadwa, men who trade with us in fairness, men of strength and men of courage. Men of honest reputation. There will also be a welcome from our allies, the Shawnees. And since you speak so well their language,
Wakatamapuk.
Their village, up the stream, a short day's journey. Room for two around the fire. Stay a little, friend, in peace.
Gladly would I dwell among you here, to trap along your river and hunt within your woodland.
Listen, beware the skulking Wyandots. There are many toward the sunset.
Although we always treat them kindly, and return them good for evil, they are never to be trusted. As a traitor, you should shun them. They will slay and scalp intruders to their land across the river, and they need no provocation. Do not tempt their cruel natures.
Wisely in the Vale of Beauty, you have placed your thriving village. Hearken to the falling waters. Yes, they are asking nature's blessings on the worthy ones who dwell here. And I would share that benediction.
I hear, Duncan. David Duncan, as for you and me, Nithitha, we shall live in peace together,
with respect for the rights of others, neither friend nor foe condemning till their moccasins we've walked in.
Friend in peace, leave not in hunger.
Clouds of pigeons bring good fortune. We shall feast on gift of manna.
Forging for his trade and safety, ties of close association with the Delawares and Shawnees, roamed he as a friendly rival, using all his speed and prowess to impress, but not outdo them, and invite their praise, not envy. To the east, through rugged ranges all along the Mingo Cross Trail, side by side they trapped the beaver, caught the muskrat and the otter, sought the raccoon, Ethepete, snared the sly mink, Chakwawashi, trailed and slew the black bear, Mugwa, trapped the red fox, Wawakachthi, shot the deer, the fleet Pishikthi, shared alike defeat and triumph. With a merchant-like devotion and assistance from the chieftains, Duncan was anon the trader when the season was propitious. With the Delawares he bartered, sold them knives and pots and blankets, calico and beads and trinkets. Bought some furs with English wampum, traded too with the Shawano, and assayed with care his dealings in the crucible of conscience. While there grew to full fruition bonds of goodwill that were golden. As his stock in trade demanded now and then, returned he eastward, with Fort Pitt his destination. From a cove far down the river where his craft of birch lay buried, camouflaged in moss and lichen. Ever mindful of the warning given by the gracious chieftain, rarely went he o'er the river. Then, in gradual defiance of the line of demarcation, as the thrill of danger beckoned, crossed alone on increased ventures, through low hills with brook-edged meadows stretching in enticement westward, to a ridge of flint deposits, once the seat of arrow making, to a distant lake in Salt Lick, tributary to the Licking, where grazed straggling herds of bison. Far within forbidden country, Boulder. Boulder, ever bolder, daring Duncan bivouacked, hunted, fished and trapped in newfound freedom. Unseen by reconnoiterers from the malcontented tribesmen was the brazen interloper. And the tide of anger mounted when he sought a trader's status in a rash, impromptu powwow with a roving band of Wyandots. As they formed a ring around him. Calling for retreat. Not valor. His deadfalls. Stole his traps. Robbed his caches. Creased his scalp. And pierced his jerkin with the tipped heads of arrows. Surreptitiously, he watched them. Saw the stealthy, wicked culprits in a plot for certain murder. Resentment wreaked its havoc on his sane and sounder judgment. Thus, they burst his bounds of patience and invoked consuming anger. To the winds he threw discretion in a bold resolve to face them. Thus engaged, he shot a felon. But he triggered more than bullets. He who fell was heir apparent. Soon, the scattered bands were gathered, called by signals from the hilltops, smoke by day and flame by darkness. And the council planned destruction as the chief in full regalia sat, enthroned by blazing campfires. And the braves, in tides of transport, threw their tomahawks at targets till they hit the mark unerring. Donned the war paint and the feathers. Danced the war dance. And their war whoops, mounting in a fierce crescendo, echoed, "War! I go to war." Then the warriors took the war path, bent on massacre and mayhem. through the forest, time forgotten, swarmed the Wyandots in frenzy, looking for the hated paleface.
Go. Stay not with us. Though I treasure much your friendship, go at once and do not tarry. They will seek you out and slay you.
But self-defense is no transgression. Is it not extenuating when you would kill your would-be slayer?
They will hound you without ceasing. They will corner you and show no mercy. Time alone will temper sorrow. It will steal away their madness. Come again when all is peaceful.
I have never shot from ambush, and they provoked the fatal battle. I shall never leave this valley.
Was it prophecy he uttered? He would never leave this valley. Here and there, the searching parties, scouting from the vantage points, saw a lone, intrepid hunter ranging, always in the distance, whom, with all their might, they followed, but he cleverly escaped them. And eluding all pursuers, disappeared as if by magic in the deepening gloom of twilight near the heights along the river. Up and down the stream, they hunted for his patent means of crossing. But their searchings all were futile. When the disappointed warriors found no clue to trail or crossing, though long hours they searched and waited, night would hear their vain conjecture.
Duncan, in his disappearance, is he man? Or is he phantom? Is it true that arrows will not penetrate his leather garments? But fall harmless from his armor?
Spirit God aids the Virginian.
To this man who speaks, Shawano, great God Manito, the mighty, and the swift wings of the eagle, for the spanning of the river.
He is master of deception, cannot fly unseen like spirit.
White man Duncan, only human. Feet are of clay and not magic. Pale-faced days are short and numbered.
Fearful of their empty caches, harbingers of winter famine, now the warpath was abandoned in reluctant resignation, and the warriors combed the uplands hunting meats for autumn drying, seeking venison for jerking, while the squaws, in Indian custom, stashing hickory nuts and pawpaws, walnuts, chestnuts, and persimmons, stood on call to tote the burdens. At approach of hound and hunter, sensing the impending danger. From a meadow's browsing, bound a stag, leaping, springing through the thickets, a departing fleeting shadow to his dazed, entranced pursuers. Safely had the buck outdistanced those who from his lair had roused him, when, with sudden consternation, came the sound of nearer voices, which revealed some fresh marauders drawing closer. Thus, the harried deer was cornered near the falls of the Muskingum. As the foremost of their party reached the crest of wood-fringed hilltop far above the rock-strewn river, he beheld, with great amazement through the leafless forest vistas, what he fain had thought his victim leaping o'er the roaring chasms, rock to rock. Soon the sable forest shadows yielded forth the trooping figures as they gathered to the signal.
From our chase, deer escaping roam unharmed across the water, but go in way undreamed of. Swim not in the flowing water, but leap from stone to stone, cross the river. As it go, so go the wizard, the lone white chief, with swiftness of eagle and of Wyandot eluding.
Forth, they sent their trained and bravest knightly now to lie in ambush, while the stars and twinkling myriads shone above in tranquil beauty. Slowly dragged the days of caution with their evenings long and lonesome. When the night wind whistled through the naked branches over Old Town's council house, implicit understanding in a rendezvous clandestine by a cheerful dancing firelight, oft did Duncan sit with White Eyes, telling stories of his people, of the white-sailed boats of commerce, of the warships and the ocean, of the soldiers of the cities. He dwelt at length on London, Paris, till the curious transfixed chieftain heard no longer, pondered deeply, sat amazed in childlike wonder. Then would White Eyes tell the legends quaint with stories and traditions which his mother told him of the early Indian people who had come from the great mountains and the land of waving prairies far beyond the Mississippi. Mirthfully, the tale related how the buffalo, Mithoto, Mishaminetok had angered and received ungainly features, spindly rump and shaggy shoulders, and was banished from the forests. Once, in reveries of sadness, he recalled the days of glory of the Delawares, departed. Gave narrations of their sojourn on the Delaware and Schuylkill as a member of Algonquin, of their internecine struggle with the powerful Iroquois, where their battle bows were broken and the tribe forever scattered by their vengeful adversaries. Prelude to a painful journey westward, never ending westward. Yet he showed no trace of malice for the wrongs his tribe had suffered. Philosophizing ere they parted, let us live in peace together, doing as we would be done by. Came the thaw, with vagrant southers in the vernal equinoctials, ushered spring in moody variance, trumpeting from sleep to waking inmates of the tomb of winter. Buoyant spring with pristine beauty came amain, resplendent, decked with dainty bloom and blossom, while across the teeming woodlands verdant tapestries unfolded. Contemplating other seasons, now and then his traps were gathered when the Storm King reigned the darkness. Frugal Scott, one trap demanded one more crossing of the river. From the firmament, a lone star pierced the rifted nimbus clouds that scudded by an infant crescent, while below, in changeful shadows, seaward swept the fair Muskingum, sighing with a gentle murmur as it reached the rock-split current where the murky, troubled water weirdly sobbed a solemn death watch. Midnight, in pervading silence, passed with dismal premonition of a sudden storm impending, as a figure, trim, athletic, darted from the eastern hillside. On his back was flung a rifle, and with pole, he lightly vaulted rock to rock the foaming river with meticulous precision. Thus, he reached the central chasm, deep. So deep the pole was worthless, as it was his wont to use it, which to him was no dilemma. Horizontally, he placed it, and with acrobatic sureness, not unlike a circus artist, moved he confident and steady. Midway on the dangerous journey, suddenly, He veered and faltered as a lurid flash of lightning turned to day in the shroud of blackness, and the shoreline just before him spurted tongues of fiery brightness, and the calm serene was shattered by the sharp report of rifles. Duncan Falls! The savage shouted as the din reverberated. Duncan Falls. The hills re-echoed in funereal notes expiring. Near his cave, the kind Muskingum left his body on the riffle. On the rocks of Dead Man's Riffle, where some searching mourners found it. With sentimental ritual, sadly carried it to Old Town.
Duncan Falls. So I lose brother. May he never be forgotten. May his praise be sung forever on the shores of the Muskingum.
So passed Duncan. Daring Duncan, peerless Nimrod of an era, foremost martyr of the traders, vanguard of the migrant millions. In his wake, rode stark disaster. As the westward trails were opened and the course of empire widened, Old Town, with its people, vanished. With the fateful inundation, forests fell before the axes, clearings yielded to the plowshares, favorite haunts were desecrated. Dreams of Indians all were shattered as the years and waters glided to their own respective oceans. To our shame, we must admit it. For our souls, we should repeat it. Red man's rights were disregarded. Good and bad alike were punished from their homelands, flushed and herded toward extinction. All were driven. Thus persists the epic legend of a quiet, peaceful valley in the Commonwealth, Ohio. Woven from its sorrel fragments on the loom of time. Enchanted. Warp of fact. And woof of fiction.